Crash Bandicoot is a really good game, even if it's a little outdated. Crash Bandicoot 2 is an even better game that fixes and expands on the original's gameplay. Crash Bandicoot Warped is another excellent game that massively expands on the gameplay of the previous two entries with new characters, vehicles, and power-ups. Crash Bandicoot: The Wrath of Cortex is very similar to Crash Warped. It plays more or less exactly the same, just on more powerful hardware with a new set of levels. However, this installment was a lot more... I'm gonna go with... controversial? It sold well, but it had a much worse critical reception than the previous entries. But why? If the gameplay was so similar, how did it do so much worse than the original trilogy? Not that trilogy. I mean, the first three Crash games. To get to the bottom of this, we're going to have to take a close look at the mechanics and level design of Crash Bandicoot: The Wrath of Cortex. Not to nitpick or make fun of it. Okay, I am going to do that a bit. But hopefully we're also going to learn something. The game lets us start with any of the first five levels, but I'm going to pick level one because, frankly, that's just the sort of person I am. By the way, I'm running this on an emulator so I can play it in HD. Don't worry about it. Ah. See this pit? Most players would just jump over it without thinking. But if you're not one of those pro gamers who reads the instructions or has played another platformer before, it might take you a few seconds to figure out what to do. But that's kind of the point. Once you get past this pit, the level designer can rest assured that you've at least figured out that you can press X to jump. Now they can do the same thing with all the other basic mechanics of the game. That way, you know that the player at least understands the fundamentals, so they won't get stuck on something that other players might take for granted. Like how in Crash 1, there's this big pile of boxes to make sure you know about the spin attack. Or how in Crash 2, there's this one specific enemy to make sure you know about the spin attack. Or this bit in Crash 3. And here in Crash 4. Fun fact, you don't have to use the spin attack until the 7th level in the Wrath of Cortex. And that's a water level, so it probably doesn't even count. The first standard level that forces you to use a spin or slide attack is the second boss fight, which is about 2/5 of the way through the game. Look, I'm not saying everybody was getting stuck here because they couldn't figure out how to press the square button, but this was the first multi-platform Crash Bandicoot game, so it probably would have been a good idea to make sure the player knows how to do a basic attack. It's worth looking at how the different types of crates are explained too. Want to see how Crash 2 shows off nitro crates for the first time? Now you know that it's a bad idea to touch nitro crates. Same goes for the switch crates in Crash 1, or the roulette crates in Crash 3. You get a clear example on their own to explain what they do. Then the Wrath of Cortex comes in with TNT crate, roulette crate, jumpy crate, bouncy crate, nitro crate, switch crate, oh look, a metal crate, watch out for that slippery ice! It's a lot of new things to introduce all at once. There's far too much here for a new player to take in, especially on the very first level of the game. Moving on. If you can get all the way to these platforms, which have awkwardly rounded edges for some reason, and you haven't died yet, you'll unlock this No Deaths platform. If you step on it, you'll be taken to an alternate path where you can pick up the blue gem.
Ooh.
This is actually a slight change to formula. The Wrath of Cortex has exactly 5 of these No Death platforms. Each one leads to one of the 5 colored gems, and then each of those gems unlocks a new path, which always ends with a clear gem. Secret level entrances from the previous games are completely gone, and this time around, you can always break every crate in the level, which unlocks another clear gem, on your first playthrough. In other words, it's always fairly obvious what you have to do to get all of the gems you need for 100% completion. which is actually listed as 106% completion, because there are 106 collectibles in the game, and, you know, maths is hard. Hot take? I actually think this is an improvement. Collecting all the gems in the old games was a massive headache. Not knowing which gems were accessible, having to backtrack without being able to actually see behind you. That one level that's only accessible by being killed by this specific pterodactyl. Yes, really. And that red gem that hovers so temptingly, just out of reach, that you spend hours trying to work out how to get to it, but you just can't figure it out, so you have to look it up online, and it turns out you were supposed to go to an entirely different level, then jump across these crates in order to get to this platform, which for some reason teleports you into a secret warp room with another entrance to the first level you're in, except this time you start in a new area which has an impossibly difficult ice skating section that eventually drops you right on top of it. Of course! Why didn't I think of that earlier? Well, at least you don't have to do all of that again when it's time to smash all the crates for the clear gem. See, the only crates in this section of the level are nitro crates, and they take care of themselves once you find the detonator a little later on. In theory, you'd be able to include all sorts of crates here, and as long as they were close enough to the nitro, they'd all be dealt with when you hit the detonator too. And by in theory, I mean this is exactly what the Wrath of Cortex does, for every single side path. Yep, every death route and gem route is covered in nitro crates, which does mean you don't have to worry about them if you're just trying to break every crate in the level. It also means the side paths can end the level without having to take you back to the main route. Unfortunately, using the same obstacles over and over again makes these sections feel very repetitive. They all revolve around awkwardly jumping over rows of nitro crates. None of them include any checkpoints either, so they're all really short too. It's a real shame, because these are the last few areas you'll play through for 100% completion. Sorry, 106% completion. This is where the game's toughest challenges are supposed to be. The ordeals that only the most dedicated players will reach. Separating the good from the great. The ultimate tests of marsupial mastery. But they can't do any of that, because they rely so heavily on this gimmicky nitro trick. There could have been so much more variety here if the boxes in the side paths just didn't count towards the total you need for the clear gem. But mainly I'm just sick of jumping over nitro crates. That said, it seems pretty clear the game wants you to go for each gem in a separate run, since they've tried to make it impossible to get both the box breaking gem and any side path gems in one go. Yes, you heard me. They tried, but did not succeed. You don't actually lose any gems you've collected when you die, and we already know that side paths don't have any checkpoints, so... Yep. I totally did that on purpose, by the way. Don't ask me how I originally figured this out. Man, I wonder how you do this bit. Oh, I see. Oh, yeah, in some of the levels, you play as Coco instead of Crash. If you're wondering what her gameplay is like, she plays exactly the same as Crash, except she can't slide, or double jump, or tiptoe, or do a death tornado, or wield a bazooka. In other words, they've taken the franchise's main female character and made playing as her feel like a punishment. I'm sure it wasn't done intentionally, but it plays right into the stereotype that girls are somehow weaker than boys. And it's even worse when you remember that in the previous game, Coco got unique level types that helped establish her as the brain to Crash's brawn. In Crash 2, she's the one who figures out what Cortex is up to. This feels like going backwards on that characterization, and it's not a great look. Hashtag not my Coco. Although it could be worse, I suppose. Okay, it's time to talk about the jumping physics in this game. The problem with this game is that the jumps are very, very floaty. You go up slow, you go down slow, and you don't lose any control while you're mid-air. This isn't a bad design choice on its own. It gives the player a lot of time and control as they land, and it would work well in a game with lots of verticality that requires precise movement as you fall. It's a problem here because Crash Bandicoot levels aren't designed like that. Crash Bandicoot levels make you constantly walk towards the screen and occasionally jump over a hole in the ground or hit a scientist across the room. In that kind of environment, it starts to feel more like you're controlling a balloon instead of a bandicoot. When I played, I was constantly overshooting platforms and jumping straight into enemies because I thought Crash had hit the ground, but he was still falling. It takes so long to reach the peak of a jump that clearing obstacles is a lot harder than it should be. And you have so much precision when you're jumping on a platform that the only way to make a single jump challenging at that point is to make you land on a single crate hovering over a bottomless pit. Which perfectly demonstrates the flaws with the new camera. One of the clever tricks the older games used was to put the camera on a fixed track. It was mainly for technical reasons, so that they could hide faraway parts of the level that hadn't loaded yet, but a side effect was that you always had a pretty good idea of where Crash was going to land. The Wrath of Cortex uses a dynamic camera, which moves up and down to follow Crash whenever he jumps. I mean, sure, it looks nice, but it makes it way harder to track where you're going to land, especially when you double jump. I mean, look, you can't even see the platform anymore. They've moved the camera closer to the ground as well. It's a bit subtle, but it makes a big difference in perspective. I mean, which one of these crates looks easier to jump on to you? As I said, these changes aren't intrinsically bad. They're just not a good match for a Crash Bandicoot game. The new camera adds a layer of frustration every time you jump, and the new jumping physics lead to some bizarre level design. Like, I'm moving left here after I've started falling. It's very strange. Speaking of new mechanics, I hear there's a new power-up in this one. Let's have a look at it in action. So we went from this to this? Really? But the original power-ups were so good. They were fun to use, they felt powerful, and they even added extra depth to the platforming. They gave you a real sense of pride and accomplishment for defeating each boss. This is nothing. You hold L2 and press a direction for a few seconds. That's it. It's used in a handful of designated locations and it's useless anywhere else. And I do mean useless, because it only works if you can walk directly on top of a nitro crate, which never comes up. It feels like it's only in here because somebody said, "Hey, we should add a new power-up in this one." But nobody could think of anything that would improve the core gameplay, so they just threw something in at the last minute. But don't worry, Super Belly Flop fans, the original first boss reward is still in the game. Inexplicably in the red gem route on level 8. Yeah, it's just kind of randomly floating there. It's a very strange place to put a power-up, because this is probably one of the last areas you're ever going to visit, and it might be confusing or annoying to reference a power-up that the player might not have yet, so the Super Belly Flop is also massively underused. Okay, we've reached the point where there are still things I want to complain about, but there's not a lot to say about each of those things individually, so I'm just going to CinemaSins it. You can hit these nitro crates but still survive, which leaves you stuck unless you can nail some awkward slide jumps, And remember, this is the very first level, so a lot of players probably don't even know about slide jumps yet. The time trial expects you to randomly roll backwards for some time crates here. It's impossible to tell how close you are to this particle effect. This bridge looks safe enough to run across without jumping, but you're just slow enough to not make it every time. The camera angle makes it really hard to tell which side of the track these crates are on. You can walk right past this crystal without picking it up. These enemies aren't even in the way, you can just walk around them. How are you supposed to dodge that? There are hidden mines everywhere, and they kill you if you slow down even a little. The submarine is a massive downgrade. It's got a huge hitbox, takes hours to turn around, and it replaces your spin attack with these unreliable explosives. Doesn't even give you an extra hit. Why are there invisible walls here? This level has a massive difficulty spike for no reason. The platform looks like it's gonna sink, but then it doesn't, but then it does. That's just not fair. You can't see Coco's shadow while you're jumping, so it's impossible to tell whether you're going to make these jumps. The controls on this level are so counterintuitive that I guarantee you'll drive into a pit the first couple times you play it. There are crates that turn you invisible, but nothing interesting ever happens with it. I have no idea where the water pistol is aiming or what I'm specifically supposed to do to hurt Crunch. If you're going for the hidden gem and you miss any of these flags, you have to replay the whole level to try again. Why is this so slow? Basically everything I said about the submarine also applies to the mech suit. Also, if you jump from a standstill while you're in the mech suit, there's a huge delay and you lose almost all air control. Each body part has its own separate health bar, but the game doesn't tell you, so you're stuck wondering why your attacks start to do no damage towards the end of the fight. Compare this to Warped, where you can see which parts of the robot are being destroyed. You have to wait ages for this turtle to carry you to the start of the level for some reason. It's impossible to tell how high this crate is on your first time through. The first platform moves you forwards, but then the second one collapses and kills you with no warning. If you die while you're attempting the death route, you get to try again. But if you die on your way back to the platform, you have to restart the whole level to try again. If you try to double jump, you'll almost always fall off these monkey bars and die. You can't tell this platform moves until it's too late. You have to use the fruit bazooka to attack Crunch, even though you can't use the bazooka in any other boss fight in the entire franchise. Also, why is Crunch attacking Cortex? The time trials let you cheat by bringing in extra Aku Aku masks. And of course, the level you can win by doing literally nothing. Seriously, I'm not even holding the controller right now. I'm playing Animal Crossing. Oh, come on, another sea bass? But none of these problems are bad enough to ruin the game on their own, right? I mean, we know the core gameplay loop works because it's identical to some of the most popular platforming games of all time. Sure, the wonky camera angle can be a pain to deal with, but it's not completely unusable. The new power-up isn't very interesting, but you only have to sit through it a handful of times. There are a few sections that will cause an unfair death or two, but they're not that difficult to get past once you figure out what you're supposed to do. And the Coco levels are pretty bad. But it's not like the first three Crash games are perfect. They've got their own issues, right? Well, that's the thing. It's not that difficult to overlook one or two problems. One bad level, one camera issue, one weird vehicle segment, one disappointing unlockable, or one poorly explained mechanic. But when a game has so many of those issues, all piling up on top of each other, they start to get a lot more difficult to ignore. And eventually, it starts to feel like the whole game is just one frustrating experience after another. But look, I know I've just spent 19 minutes talking about the parts of this game that I don't like, but it's not like it's a terrible game. It's okay, it's fine, about average. It's a good time as long as you can handle a little bit of frustration. And yeah, it might not be the most original PS2 era Crash game, but it does hold up better than the other offerings of the time. Let's just say the golden age of Crash Bandicoot was definitely over. So, if you're looking for a worthy sequel to Crash Bandicoot Warped that innovates on the core gameplay while adding a modern flair with more powerful hardware, go play Crash 4. But if you're looking for a case study on how small design decisions can make or break a game, The Wrath of Cortex is an excellent choice. Wait, the one where they time travel is called Warped, and the one where they warp through different dimensions is called It's About Time? Are we sure that's the right way around?